Vanakkam, Namaskar, good morning. It is a pleasure to be talking to you all. I just recollected, this is the 56th year I am facing the students. I've been talking to some of my friends in the morning. They have an advantage over all of you because I am the oldest person around. I am reaching 80. This morning, Arjun gave a very, very interesting way of looking at things. Do what it considers to be, what you consider to be your interest. Most likely, if you have an interest, you have the talent also. And India does not lack opportunities. It offers enormous opportunities. I am one among the examples. I am going to take you to Ajanta. Let's all go for a quick round of Ajanta. I have been interested in the heritage, Indian heritage. Among many things, I got interested in Ajanta. Just for your information, there are 29 caves in Ajanta, and this holds a very unique position in Indian art history. This is going to be my journey along with you today. I hope I will be able to complete, take you around in 18 minutes. It all started. Ajanta is a place where you find 29 caves which have been excavated from the 2nd century BC to the 6th century AD. But after about 9th century, nothing is known about this place. And suddenly about 200 years ago, in 1819, a chap in the cavalry, a cavalry officer of British Army, 1819, he was going on a tiger hunt and finally stumbled onto a number of caves, 29 of them. And when he went inside, my God, nobody could have imagined it. The entire place is all painted except for the floor. Now, who could have thought about this one? And walls, ceilings, pillars, everything. And he did the desecration of a heritage site by inscribing his name on it, John Smith, on a particular day in August in 1819. This is the most famous and acceptable desecration of any monument. And next year will be the 20th year of the rediscovery of Ajanta. Why all this excitement? I will come to this later. First of all, it is a great architecture of very high order. And its sculptures and paintings that take the breath away. Let us have a quick glance as painted by Dibin in the middle of the 19th century. He has made the painting of what existed at that time, as seen by the pioneers. You can see how bad it is maintained. This is inside a vihara, a chaitya, the inside of it, which is the temple, the Buddhist temple. Then you have the inside of a monastery where the monks used to live. Just to see what the kind of paintings you have on the ceilings, on the walls, and the architecture of the cave itself with all the pillars and so on. Next. But this magnificent work of art, architecture, and contemplation were abandoned to wild animals, insects, floodwaters, prodigious foliage for more than 1,000 years. What a pity. This chance discovery opened floodgates. Okay. And people started clearing the debris and finding out how to preserve the whole place. And you can see how it would have been those days. Even today you can find a stray tiger into the cave. It is taken something like 20 years ago. So you could have seen what would have been the situation 150 years ago. And Robert Gill was the pioneer who went into this one. He spent about 10 years and died in harness. He copied the paintings. Sitting there, now you can really imagine in the year 1844, what would have been the condition there? No electricity, no water, no place for them even for their private work and so on. And Gill, finally, the person died there itself, and he is buried in Bhusawal, near, very close to Jalgaon, where the caves are. There was another painter called Simpson, who painted Gill painting the caves. What you see there? Is there a pointer here? Okay. Gill is painting and Simpson has painted this. Later, a lady came from the US, UK. She was interested in conserving and spreading the message of Indian art among the Western minds. She came here. She stayed there for 10 years. Most of the time in the precincts of the camera, the caves itself, and painted almost all the, reproduced most of the paintings on the walls of Ajanta. The frenzy continues even today. Here is a man, Professor Walter Spink, who is an emeritus professor today in the Michigan State University, Ann Arbor. And he came first to the caves for his honeymoon, probably at the age of 35 or so. And he is coming every year from then onwards, and he is 90 today. You can understand the kind of passion that he has. He is being carried around on a wheelchair. And the terrain is not very simple. Ajanta Caves, the terrain is not very simple. And even today he is coming. His study is so deep, what he has done is, whether his thesis you are going to accept or not, that's a different matter. He has annually chronologized every year what cave was excavated, in what sculpture has been made, what painting has been made every year by year. That's a fantastic amount of work. Of course, done over 60 years. And his study has resulted in a prodigious amount of documentation. This documentation is available to us all. And he is a very interesting person. He is ready to come and sit down with you and talk to you also. I am also one among those enthusiasts. I have spent 25 years in documenting, not as an expert, but somebody who can talk to you, make you understand our heritage. Our heritage is something that we must be able to understand, appreciate, and imbibe the culture. And I have done enormous amount of work taking almost all the available literature. I have made an interactive CD where you can visit, virtual visit of every painting and also every sculpture there. Yes, of course, it is available to you all. I can hand it over to you anytime. I have also made a 382 leaf portfolio, taking every painting and describing in detail. This is my kind of passion. And there is one, Dieter Schlingloff, presently in the University of Michigan. Remember, he is also 90. Has made drawings of every painting. He has drawn the land diagram of every painting and also every scratch there. And he has also produced excellent documentation. There is one Shambhu Prasad Baukhandi, who has been appointed by the Delhi Museum, National Museum in Delhi, and he spent 30 years reproducing these paintings. Now, what is so great about these caves? You can see About 1,000 years ago, 1,200 years, why? 2,200 years ago, they have made excavated caves. The size of the cave is no smaller than some of these things like this. The entire hall, you can take it as a cave. Now you can imagine using only chisel and hammer. They have made these caves. They have made, it's not just to make, just hewing a cave, but they have included pillars, walls, ceilings, plastered them, painted them fully. Now they have done it 2,200 years ago, and they continued for next 800 years. Now imagine, this is a cave excavated. The amount of material that was there has been removed. It is cutting in. And using, again, I am telling you, only chisel and hammer. And they did not have any other facility. And not a simple type of, very ordinary kind of sculptures. There is life in it, creating such living images in hard rock. And these are hard rock. Aren't this lively? Now we are seeing it after 1,600 years. And painted. All over the place. Beautiful painting. I am going to talk about the painting slightly later. But remember, these caves will get sunlight only during a part of the day. About 2 to 3 hours a day. And the remaining portion, he will have to have oil lamps and so on. And what they have painted is something superb. And they have also painted on the ceiling, as high as this, 15 feet. Just imagine the enterprise, what would have been the enterprise 2,200 years ago to 1,600 years ago. All these are Buddhist caves. Some are temples and others are monasteries. The theme of the sculptures and paintings are anecdotes from the life of the Buddha and the Buddhist mythological stories called Jatakas. There are also ornamentation that I am not taking it as the theme. Let us have a quick round of the caves. Isn't it simply marvelous? Remember, India does not make models. The Indian tradition is directly go and make it. It will be my pleasure if I were to come and tell you how we make our temples. No models are made, no sculptures, there is a model for a sculpture and so on. It is directly coming from the mind. Okay. Now, this is the entrance. This is an interior of a temple called Chaitya. And again, keep in mind, this is not something that is structured or constructed. This has been hewn out of solid rock. Don't you think this is fantastic? If you go there, you become insignificant, let me tell you. Simply because this is an interior of a monastery. What you see on the end, these are all entrance to the rooms where the monks used to stay. See the ceiling? Imagine painting on the ceiling, the very enterprise of painting on the ceiling, those days. You know, you must have scaffolding up to that place. There is no light. And I am going to show you some of the painting, details of the painting. And these paintings of Ajanta are unexcelled even today. Even today, there is nothing better than Ajanta you can find in this country. Now let us see what makes Ajanta unique. Art of every culture goes through many stages of development. This natural process takes place in many locations over a long period of time. For example, if we take the art after the Renaissance in Europe, it has taken in different places over a different period of time. However, but in India, it has taken place in one location, that is Ajanta. That is very unique. That is, you see the pre-classical or the archaic stage, 2nd century to the 1st century BCE. There is a lapse of about 2 centuries. Again, from the 4th century onwards, there is a classical period. And it goes into ornamentation called Baroque, there later Rococo, and finally it declines by the end of the 6th century. All these things you can see within the campus, within the place called Ajanta Caves, there are 29 of them. Very sophisticated techniques to bring out depth and relief employed. For example, if you want to show the third dimension, drawing lines following the contour of the body is one method called Patraja. Patraja means like the one that you see on the back of any leaf, Patra. That is called one method. The other method is you just put dots, more dots or less dots, concentration, just to show the relief. Then the wash technique. All the three you can see on the walls of Ajanta. And there are many more. Now, I would like to dwell upon it a little more. Contemporary fashion in textiles, dress, ornaments look very sophisticated. What you see on the walls of Ajanta are number of textiles, dyes, dyeing, resist dyeing, discharge printing, and so on. One among them, and also almost all the kinds of dresses that you find today, you can see on the walls. And Ikkat. It is what you call Patola, Pochamballi, and Sambalpur, where the yarn is dyed, and when you weave it, you get a design. And in Patola, in Gujarat, there are only 3 families left of this 2,000-year-old paramparyam. And you have socks, knitting. And you have ornaments of all kinds. You can see it for even today. Earrings, and it has influenced all the places in the country and also all over the Buddhist world in the world. Finally, Ananda Kumaraswamy says, the frescoes of Ajanta preserve an infinitely precious record of the golden age of Indian painting. This is the picture of halcyon age where renunciation and enjoyment are perfectly attuned and not at once and utmost intimacy and reserve. Thank you very much. Thank you very much.